Hey guys, hello and welcome to channelfireball.com. My name is Caleb Durward, and this is a Boro Splash Green or Naya pump deck. I've been calling it Pumpaholic just because I like the name. I don't know, it reminds me of The Simpsons. At one episode, and Homer goes to Anger Anonymous or something, and talks about Rageahol and getting addicted to... Well, I'm getting off topic. Anyway, so the thing that I like about this deck is that it's very, very focused. You play pump spells, all of your creatures get benefits from the pump spells, and then you win the game. Myth Realized works really well as both a threat to trigger off of your pump spells, very, very similar to a prowess creature, only gets to keep the counters, so it's a little bit slower to get going, but once it gets going, it's much more powerful. It plays an interesting role in this deck because of that. It's like a Quirion and Dryad, you know. It's like a Quirion and Dryad that's also a spell that pumps your other Quirion and Dryads. If that makes sense. And your whole deck is cards that get pumped by it. And so because it's so efficient, so easy to slip into your curve, I think it has a place here. And then at a certain point, even if your opponent deals with your early aggression, the Myth Realized just starts taking over the game. Like, you attack, it's like a 4-4 or a 5-5. They can't block with their 4-4s or their 5-5s because you're threatening to just pump it just on board just by having 4 mana. You can activate it and then give it +1/+1. And that's pretty big. If you've ever been beaten down by an Anafenza before and your opponent's like other creature that's just getting the 1-1 counters every turn, even if it's just 1/+1/+1 counter a turn, it can get to be too big to handle. But most of the time, it's just a little efficient threat that serves from between 2 and 4 damage, can carry pump spells really well, and pumps the team. So that's the most unique card in the deck. The rest of the deck is very focused around the pump strategies. There are some like mono reddish type or red splash green, Titan Strength, Swift Spear, Abbott, Battle Rage, Become Immense decks in standard. But they're not playing white, so they don't have Defiant Strike, they don't have white threats in Myth Realized, Seeker of the Way, Monastery Mentor, Gideon, and they don't have access to white removal. So those are all some pretty big pluses for playing this version of the deck. Those are all good strengths to have. One thing that people don't realize when they're thinking about white threats is that Surge of Righteousness is a very popular sideboard card right now, and if half of your creatures are just not targets for Surge, it means that card is way less effective against this version of the Tamir Battle Rage Become Immense deck than any other version that's currently being played. So that's kind of sweet. Something else that's not very apparent on paper, but you start to really appreciate once you start playing the deck, is that Gideon is an awesome, awesome card in a very aggressive deck. So something that Gideon does in this deck that it just does not do anywhere else in Magic is receive pump spells like Tamir Battle Rage. Just by itself, Gideon and Tamir Battle Rage is a whopping 10 damage with trample. That's absurd. Like, so does Gideon make a 2/2. If your opponent can't deal with the Gideon, they might just die. They might just actually die. And Gideon is a card that gets through a lot when you attack with it, because it's not like the opponent can block to trade with it. So sometimes it just ends up getting pumped anyway. It's been pretty sweet so far. That said, you don't want to draw multiples, because drawing multiples can get a little bit too clunky. You know, you don't want that many 4 drops in this deck. We only have 23 lands, but having a few has been really nice for me so far. And it's like the Myth Realized, it's a threat that you play that also triggers all of your other threats. Like, it anthems your team for the turn, which is pretty sweet. So you can like get sort of a double anthem effect out of it. Like, if you have some Abbots and Seekers and go Gideon, make an emblem, you can just get a lot more damage across the board than you normally would. The Mentor is still relatively new, but I like it a lot on paper. It seems really sweet in this deck as another way of winning off of all the same cards. Still has prowess, generates a little army, a little bit clunkier than these other earlier threats, but just very, very powerful card. And when I shaved the third Gideon, Mentor made a lot of sense. And then there's Den Protector, which people have played in this deck before. It's pretty good as an evasive threat. Because when you pump it, there's just very few creatures in Magic that can actually block it if you give it +6/+6. So that's kind of cool. And then if you end up into a grindy game, you do have the option of morphing it too, which can come up. It's pretty rare. Usually you just play it as a 2-drop Overall, I think it's one of the worst threats in the deck. I could see cutting it for a second mentor, but right now I think it's fine. I've been keeping it. There are certainly games where Den Protector does things that only Den Protector can do. So it kind of takes away from the focus of the deck because everything else like has prowess, everything's a little bit more fluid and explosive than the Den Protector. But because it has that pseudo-evasion, because it attacks from a slightly different angle, I've definitely won games because I had it in the deck, and I've definitely appreciated it. So I'm going to keep the one copy for now. Most of the sideboard cards are various removal spells. Let's see, anything else to go over? I don't think so. Overall, I think a lot of the deck is just counting. Like, you're just building your Mithrilized, you're just getting in damage, you're eating your opponent's creatures when they block, you're just, like, letting them take damage when they don't block. Most of the time, it's correct to just go for the win. So in my write-up on the deck, I said that the deck wasn't that hard to play, because even if you make a mistake, the deck is still very inherently powerful, and it can bail you out of those situations. And then usually if you make a mistake, like say you play into the removal spell and they have it, it's not that big of a mistake, because if they don't have the removal spell, they're dead. You know, like it's a difficult deck to play perfectly, but if you play it imperfectly, it's still a very good deck, in my opinion. So that's why I recommended it. That's why I said it wasn't that difficult to play, even though there can be some very tricky lines of thought when playing out the deck. I don't think you have to be that good to play it and win with it. Anything else? Oh, I realize that I'm talking a little bit quietly right now, but I've got some roommates that have to get up very early in the morning, so I'm a little bit on the softer side, so my apologies there. But I am excited to play this deck some, so hopefully we have some interesting games going into this daily event. See you guys in round one.